I have to be really careful because last night I was doing a stand-up comedy gig and I realised it's a very different audience. No, really it is, if you've heard what I've said. I'm here on behalf, personally, of Not Dead Yet UK, but on behalf really of all the disability groups who've joined us. Disabled people feel very frightened about the possibility of the assisted dying bill. Now, when we talk today, I'm not going to talk about assisted dying, I'm going to talk about assisted suicide. And I implore you that if you oppose this bill, to use that language. The Dignity in Dying were the biggest lobbying campaign in support of assisted dying law. We'll have us believe that this is not about assisted suicide. But we don't believe that because that comes from an organisation who were once called the Voluntary Euthanasia Society. And they know the power of words. They're very clever. Just by changing the words does not change what this is about. This is about assisted suicide. It is about legalising somebody assisting you to end your life. More specifically, it's about legalising a doctor, a medical profession, to assist you to end your life. That's massive. I am not going to talk about personal stories. The press love them. Our opponents love them. They love emotion. They love sentimentality. They love fear. But you cannot pass a piece of legislation based on fear. You pass a piece of legislation to keep the majority of your population safe. Not for the very articulate few who are asking for this ultimate choice. I'm concerned about the welfare of everybody. I'm not concerned particularly about me. I'm loud and I'm articulate and I'm on telly, so I'm doing quite well. But that's not the majority of disabled people or older people or ill people or vulnerable people or poor people or working class people. That's not the majority of those people. They're the people that I worry about, who don't have the support that they need, who don't have the health care, who don't have the drugs that they need, who don't have social care, who don't have the housing they need so they can live independently with their families. The people that aren't getting hospice support because we're not supporting them, possibly. The people that aren't getting their choice when they die at home or in a hospital. Let's sort that out. My God, if Dignity in Dying use the millions they get to ensure everyone has a good end of life experience, I would join up. Because I just want to ask everybody in the room something. Who here believes that everybody is entitled to a pain-free and dignified end of life? Who believes that everybody is entitled to a pain-free and dignified end of life? It's everybody. Because you wouldn't be human if you said, no, I want to die in pain and an evil death. We all want the same, and actually whatever side of the debate you're on, we want the same. We just don't believe that legalising assisted suicide is the way to go. You will be licensing doctors to give terminal drugs, to give drugs, lethal drugs, to people. People in distress. People who've just been told that they've got less than 6 months to live. Can you imagine how that's going to mess with your head? Can you imagine how terrified you would feel to get that diagnosis? Some people in this room will have had that and you'll know that. Terrifying. Disabled people who become newly disabled. How terrifying. We are not people that lack compassion, as we're often told. We don't have capital punishment. Capital punishment is the right one. We probably have corporal punishment. But we have capital punishment. We don't allow that. Because even after a full investigation by the police, and a court case, there can still be miscarriages of justice. And yet, two signatories by doctors, and I don't know about you, but I can't even get an appointment with my doctor. So situate this bill in your local healthcare centre. Do that, make it real for people. Can your doctor, because this is what they'll have to do, can they diagnose you? Can they prognose you within 6 months? Can they check your mental capacity? Can they check that you're voluntary giving consent? And can they check that you're not under any undue pressure? Because when I go to my GP, she thinks I'm marvellous just for leaving the house. So I'm not convinced she can do all those things for me. in an objective way. There is no requirement, don't anyone say that there are safeguards in these bills. There are criteria. They're all criteria that I've just read out. They're not safeguards, okay? There is no requirement that somebody has a psychiatric assessment. Now, come on, if anybody else asks to end their life, what they're given, hopefully, suicide prevention. They're given support and they're dissuaded. If you're ill or disabled and you say you want to die, people go, how can we help? To the point that we fought this with the Lib Dems, I don't know if there's anyone with the Lib Dems here, zero tolerance on suicide, supportive of assisted suicide. Why is there one rule for one group of people and another rule for another group of people? This is about discrimination. Now, people have started to talk about this right to die. Rubbish. Rubbish. We already have that. We're all going to die, by the way. It's not a right, it's a fact. Sorry to break that to you, but it's going to happen. What people want is a right to be killed. That's how the socially approved suicide. That's what this bill is about. Socially approving suicide. It's a massive change. And do you know what? Once you say there's a right to die for one group of people, it makes absolute sense that that will be extended to other groups. It's not a slippery slope. That's rubbish. Don't use the phrase. It's a political phrase is incremental extension. It's what happened. They know what they're doing. And let me tell you how I know this. I know this for a number of reasons. So I was fortunate enough through the Churchill Foundation Trust to get to travel the world, I know, to explore all the countries where assisted suicide is legal. And when I went to Luxembourg, can you believe, beautiful little Luxembourg, if assisted suicide and euthanasia are illegal there, are legal, sorry. And I met the two politicians who brought in the law, and I said to them, are you happy with the law? And they were like, not really. Oh, okay, it's for terminally ill people and people who are suffering. They said, yeah, but we would have liked it to be for young people, children, and for people with dementia. Okay, so why did you not put that through the courts, through the parliament? Because we knew we wouldn't get it. They said, we knew we could persuade people to pass a law for terminally ill people. That's common sense. They're dying anyway, assisted dying, let's call it what, you know, let's use that euphemism. It's for people who are dying, we're just assisting them on their peaceful way. No. The legislators themselves admitted this was a political move to get it passed. So don't be under any illusions that what we hear is only about terminally ill people. It isn't. And how I know that too, and many of us in this room know, if you think about the very high profile campaigns for assisted suicide legislation, I'm going to name some names. Who have been the poster children for it, yeah? We started way, way back with Diane Pretty, Debbie Purdy, Tony Nicholson, Paul Lamb. Recently, Jeffrey Spector, Terry Pratchett. Not one of them is terminally ill. Not one of them would come under the law that they're trying to get through at the moment. Not one of them. Many of them couldn't use the law because people like Tony Nicholson didn't have the mobility, he had locked-in syndrome, to actually do the act himself. So what's happening, and this is again something that the campaigners for know that they're doing, is that what they're doing is they're changing society's perspective on assisted suicide. That's what they're doing. And I know this, again, because when I was in America, I met the equivalent of Dignity of Dying called Compassion and Choices. And the woman there, Barbara Coomsley, very well-known advocate of assisted suicide and self-determination, she said it takes 10 to 15 years of changing the tide of public opinion, and then you'll pass a law. They know what they're doing. They absolutely know it's planned, and that's why the blur between who's terminally ill, who's disabled, is important in this. Recently, do we remember Jeffrey Spector? The Last Supper gentleman who went to Dignitas. Not even disabled. Fearful of becoming disabled. And yet still, wholeheartedly, in the press and the public, people supported his right to die. I was like him, I want that. Wow. And that's why disabled people are terrified. Because that's us. We get told to our faces, I don't know how you exist. I don't know how you cope. If I was like you, if I was incontinent, my God, I couldn't be dignified. Anybody can have human worth and dignity, no matter what they can and cannot do. They cannot if they're not getting the support they need. I'd like to say that. I have to say that. People are not getting the support that they need. They are not valued in society. If we valued older, disabled, and ill people, maybe I wouldn't be so frightened of this bill. But I am terrified. And please, don't ever forget that your voice is really, really important. Every time I speak on this issue to people who are opposed, I convert at least one person. I have no doubt, purely because they've never heard our issues. They've never heard it put another way. They're just fed the stream of emotional issues of, oh my God, look at this person who's dying. Well, actually, let's look at all these people that need the support and us to be there for them. Don't offer suicide encouragement, offer suicide prevention. Now, I'd like to leave with a couple of things. The main thing being, and it's something that really struck me, it's a campaigner from America, from the American group Not Dead Yet, who said, if this bill passes, and she was talking about the Oregon law at this point, which we now have, some people's lives will be ended without their consent through mistakes and abuse. No safeguards have ever been enacted or proposed that can prevent this outcome, and that can never be undone. Very powerful, remember that. This, you get the sense when you're hearing Dignity in Dying's spiel, let's say, in their PR. You forget this is about human life. It's about life and death.